the Mediterranean, a forgotten Eden. It has shared its riches with people for thousands of years. Home to mysterious places and scenes of past tragedies. A world that still harbors astonishing untold secrets in its blue depths. Adventure Ocean Quest. An encounter with a world under the waves. With divers who become underwater beings themselves. They work together with scientists on all the world's oceans. Deep under the surface of the water. Without a sound and without a breath. Adventure in the depths of the sea, the likes of which has never been seen before. Freediver Frédéric Bouilly is on an extraordinary quest. For thousands of years, the Mediterranean had been abused and turned into a veritable cesspool by the people living along its shores. Now he wants to take stock. What condition will he find the Mediterranean in? And how have people changed this underwater world? His extraordinary freediving abilities, sensitivity, and not least his courage allow Frédéric to become part of his underwater surroundings. He manages to uncover spectacular secrets that remain hidden to most. Only a diver that behaves like a fish is able to really get close to them. His noiseless and extremely flexible diving technique allows him to investigate places that remain out of reach for conventional divers. He can experience this world in a new way. He's searching for traces of the underwater paradise that the Mediterranean used to be. 50 kilometers off the French coastline near Marseille, lies the Galabon, ready to begin a three-week expedition of the Mediterranean. The Mediterranean has a surface area of around 2.5 million square kilometers and is among the most ravaged sea regions in the world. On board, an unusual team, anxious to begin their mission. It includes a renowned underwater cinematographer and two of the best freedivers in the world. Christian Petron has a wealth of experience, including Luc Besson's cult movie, The Big Blue. The Belgian Frédéric Bouilly, former world record holder that has now devoted himself to underwater photography. His security diver is the record-breaking freediver, William Winram.
So I heard from a lot of people that there's not much life in the Med. And, you know, I mean, I've only dove around Nice and a few other places and not seen a lot of fish, so. Don't know what to expect.
You'll be surprised. With Christian, we're going to show you some of the nicest place, and it will change your idea about the Mediterranean Sea forever.
Really?
Yeah.
I look forward to it.
Finally, the expedition gets underway. They're heading east to the island of Porquerolles and the wreck of the Donateur, the remains of a freighter that hit a mine after the end of World War II and sank. Wrecks have always been favorite dive spots, not least because of the sense of mystery and danger that surrounds them.
For me, that kind of dive is the essence of freediving. It's what I like to do in freediving, because going to 50 meter zone with current, no visibility, no line to guide you, and just use your senses to get, somehow it's a sixth sense to find a wreck, because you don't know exactly where it is. You feel maybe the big metallic mass at the bottom of the sea to guide you. I think that's the essence of freediving.
Okay, this morning we look for diving on the Donato. It's a wreck sinking during the just after the World War II. Mm-hmm. Very, very nice work.
We have to do a good diving plan. William and I will be able to do 4 dives, not more. No. Also, on the wreck, when we arrive first, there is a lot of chance to see a big school of fish with Dentex, bream, and sar. So we have to be very silent when we arrive on top of the wreck, not to scare them away. If they are there, it's very spectacular. You will see a lot of fish. The problem is in the middle of the channel between these two islands, which means you have a lot of current there. Yeah. That's why it's a rich wreck, but also it makes a very difficult dive. Yeah. Okay, let's go.
From their base on the Gare Le Bon, the team approaches the Donateur's wreck site with a more versatile Zodiac. The weather looks promising, but it gives little indication of the conditions below the water surface. Currents, visibility, and water temperature are all unknown. For dives like this one in considerable depths, everything has to be just right, no matter how experienced the divers might be. Dead ship are overrun with life. It seems nature has conquered the barren bleakness of human technology and turned it into a true paradise. The colors revealed by the spotlights are incredible. And although the color red is swallowed up in the blue depths, it is there, spectacularly exposed by the artificial light. This dive is a serious challenge for the free divers. Just to get here and back, they have to cover over 100 meters on a single breath. Once at the wreck, they have to be careful to conserve energy to avoid a potential blackout on the way back. Reefs are like underwater islands in the blue expanse of the ocean. They offer shelter and food for all kinds of underwater creatures. And while the wreck of the Donateur is an artificial island, it has been here for over 60 years, allowing masses of organisms to colonizing it, turning it into a true underwater city. The wreck attracts divers in droves. On resurfacing, Fred and Will have to be extremely careful not to be hit by the numerous boats. A collision with the ship's propeller could be fatal.
Bonne journée.
Bonne journée.
Underwater, peace and quiet prevails. Until the scuba divers arrive, everything changes dramatically. The exhaled bubbles from all these divers now dominate the wreck. Mud is whirled up from the seabed. The fish retreat. Fred, there is nothing left to see here.
It's really interesting. When we arrived, our first two dives at 20 meters, you could see the wreck clearly. Now, with all the movement on it and all the sediment being stirred up, at 20, it's barely visible.
Puppet show down there. I've already 110 divers. With that boat arriving, will be more than 150 in the same dive spot. It's just crazy.
It's time for the divers to have a rest. For Christian Petron, this expedition is part of a personal mission. 25 years ago, he already documented the catastrophic pollution of the French Mediterranean to raise awareness of its enormous scale.
Voilà, regarde. Ça, c'est des images tournées.
These are the pictures we filmed 25 years ago in front of Marseille. There was absolutely no treatment of the raw sewage, nothing. No, nothing was treated. This was practically the toilet for 300,000 people. It all went directly into the sea. It was a real cesspool. We went diving here to show the damage to the coastal waters. Everything was dead here. The fish, all dead. It was a disaster.
Shocking pictures like these were part of the trigger for one of the most progressive environmental projects in the Mediterranean. A massive artificial reef in the Bay of Marseille. Sandrine Ruiton from the Université de la Méditerranée is the scientific leader of the project. She takes Fred out to the reef. This project could be compared to the reforestation of a desert.
This is the map of the artificial reefs. That's interesting because we've built several ecosystems next to each other, which benefit from each other, as you can see. The inside of the artificial reef is made up of concrete boxes. They allow a complex structure and provide a variety of living spaces for different species.
The buoy is there for the diver's orientation. From the surface, it's impossible to make out this new-built estate for underwater creatures. It lies at a depth of around 20 or 30 meters. Hobby divers and fishermen are banned from this area. Disturbances are to be kept to a minimum. But the free diver's sensitive and unobtrusive technique is ideal. Fred approaches the artificial reef cautiously. He's concerned not to scare any of its residents away. But visibility is very poor, and Fred has to move closer. He is completely noiseless. It's his only chance to catch a glimpse of the shy fish.
I dived from below and approached the reef from below. Above it, I saw a few sea bream there.
Oh, that's interesting. That's an important fish. You've surely seen a lot of little fish as well.
Yeah, that's right. But I didn't disturb them.
Sandrine takes pictures of the organisms that have begun to settle here. Algae and invertebrates are the first to take up residence and form the basis of a new food chain.
Yeah, interesting. It's a big structure and a lot of fish just swimming on top of it. And the fish noticed my presence, but they were not too afraid. And then when I started to be really on the reef, they went slowly in open water. But it's interesting to see it. It works. That structure really works to aggregate fish. It's very interesting.
The developments are documented meticulously. A mass of factors influence the success or failure of the project. Currents, depth, and the structure of the build are all instrumental. But the divers don't just find signs of the gradual settlement of the new reef. Sandrine also finds a fishing net that has got caught in the structure. It is a definite sign that fishermen are ignoring the no-go zone. Artificial reefs are only part of the efforts to bring life back to the coastal waters of the Mediterranean. The most important step was to build sewage treatment works to restore the water quality sufficiently to support life. Sandrine shows Fred the progress made in the structure's settlement. Some fish are beginning to return. They in turn will provide food for bigger fish in the future. And the project's success will be directly beneficial for local people too. The small fishermen of Marseille will once again be able to make their living right outside their city. It will take decades for the sea to recover completely. There is now a glimmer of hope. The expedition's next destination is Corsica. This is an exceptional location for divers. The visibility of the water is famous, and there are more than just shipwrecks to explore beneath the waves. Just outside the town of Calvi, an American bomber crashed into the sea. Unlike the wreck of the Donateur, hardly any life has settled here. Perhaps it's simply too small to make an attractive home for fish. Not far away, lies the nature reserve of Scondola, where Fred has been given an exceptional permission to dive. For all other divers, this area is a strict no-go zone. The sheer diversity of life here is not at all evident from the word go. But Scondola is home to some exceptional treasures of the Mediterranean Sea. Huge rock outcrops have created an exceptional habitat complete with canyons and rock overhangs that provide secure living quarters for a myriad of creatures. And that applies not only to fish, but also a completely different type of organism, the rare red corals of the Mediterranean. Red corals are strictly protected here. They've been popular assets for jewelry for thousands of years, but over time, their merciless exploitation has reduced their numbers greatly. But the beauty of these corals is most evident when they're still alive. Once turned into jewelry, nothing is left of the fragile coral polyps that once live in these calcareous structures. Occasionally, there are also completely white corals. The hordes of hobby divers found on the wreck of the Donateur would be a disaster for this finely tuned ecosystem. It would spell the end for this coral colony. But long-term observations have shown that these coral colonies are gradually improving. Harvesting corals has been a long tradition in Corsica. But these days, only a handful of professional coral divers are still allowed to harvest them outside the protected areas. In Bonifacio, in the south of Corsica, Fred meets Jean-Philippe Giordano, one of the last men to make his living from the corals. He's not only a diver, but also crafts the coral jewelry himself. The coralleur has become an extremely rare occupation. Jean-Philippe knows the few hidden places along the coast of Bonifacio where corals can still be found. While Fred dives without the aid of air tanks, just like the coral divers of the past, modern scuba diving equipment allows a much longer search underwater. But despite this, being a coral diver is still very dangerous. The long dives at considerable depths have cost many a coral collector their life. Jean-Philippe collects the corals by hand, and only as many as he can currently work on. One of the reasons why corals cannot be cultivated is that their growth rates are extremely slow, only a few millimeters every year. So it takes decades for the tiny polyps to build up a structure of just a few centimeters. Collecting them is back-breaking work. The coralleur has to leave many corals standing to allow them sufficient time to recover. To follow Jean-Philippe, Fred has to dive to almost 50 meters. There are hardly any corals left in shallower waters. The industrial harvest of corals involves nets that are dragged over the ground and destroy large areas of the seabed completely. It is now strictly prohibited around Corsica. There is hope that over time these protective measures will allow coral stocks to recover here. But the successful search for corals is only the beginning of the coralleur's work. Even today, the most beautiful corals used for jewelry still come from the Mediterranean. While most other types of corals cannot be used for jewelry because they're too brittle, the Mediterranean coral has a particularly beautiful, colored, hard, calcareous exoskeleton that can be worked on with ease. Legend has it that the corals were made from the blood of the Medusa when Perseus cut off her head. Today, their color only serves as a reminder of the beautiful contrast of the red corals against the blue of the sea. Back at the coast of the French Mediterranean, Fred visits one of the oldest nature reserves here, the island of Port-Cole. It is under constant observation from park rangers to ensure its protection. Port-Cole was turned into a French national park in 1963. It was the first national park in Europe that combines both land and sea. The island is surrounded by a protected zone of 600 meters, which includes a number of smaller islets. Once in private ownership, the island was turned over to the French state by its former owners, under the provision that the island's natural beauty would be preserved and the building of hotels prohibited. Fred meets the representative of the park's management, Nicolas Giratin. He's particularly proud that the endangered stocks of dusky groupers in this protected area are gradually beginning to recover.
The increase in the populations of groupers are very significant because we were counting about 40 groupers in l'Îlot de la Gabinière in 1985, and now we are about to 200 on this same place, and altogether it's between 500 and 600 around the island. In 1985, we had something like 40 groupers and about 1,200 dive every year. Mm-hmm. If you compare 1,200 dive, 1,200 flashlights towards 40 groupers, they might get mad in a few months, you know, because no one of us could stand such a treatment. The other problem was that it's easier to make a photograph of a grouper to make him come towards you than to try and chase him. The groupers love boiled eggs. 40 groupers, 1,200 boiled eggs. They might be sick in a few weeks if everybody brings boiled eggs. So we had to avoid the people and recommend to the divers that they wouldn't bring any food to the fish, because we, apart from the fish, we need to maintain a biological chain and not interfere with it.
I think the National Park of Port-Cole were a pioneer in a way to use apnées and free divers for scientific work.
The apnea is the best way, it's the most natural way to get into the water, the most silent way without any noise in the water, but also any noise outside when you have to pump the lungs and all the logistic which is behind.
The waters of Port-Cole are now so carefully monitored that to dive here requires a special permission from the National Park authorities. It is only granted if the strict regulations are followed. To conduct population surveys of dusky groupers, the rangers tend to work together with free divers like Fred. It means minimum disturbance to the environment and its inhabitants. Since the fish are curious and not at all shy, they make an easy target for hunters. And although population numbers of dusky groupers in these protected waters have increased tenfold in the last decade, they are still an endangered species. During the mating season, do the males get a little testy and see anything and anyone as a potential rival. Under the water surface, the visitor is confronted with a myriad of different landscapes. Rocky mountains are dissected with light valleys covered with seagrass. The seagrass meadows are home to an astonishing array of animals and plants, and their dense roots help to stabilize the seafloor. But this delicate carpet is easily damaged by dragnets and ship's anchors. And since seagrass grows and recolonizes only slowly, entire underwater meadows can be quickly and seriously damaged, threatening the survival of the entire habitat. It's a tranquil underwater oasis on the edge. But there is a completely different underwater world, one hidden from view. Fred and Will prepare to meet a particular challenge, a journey into the deep, with no easy escape to the water surface. Caves, dark, hidden, and mysterious. This is a world that puts high demands on the abilities of the free divers. The entrance alone lies 20 meters below the surface. It harbors a bizarre spectacle. Stalactites and stalagmites are witnesses of a bygone age when this cave lay suspended high above the water surface. What happens if the divers run out of air? It is impossible to resurface right in the middle of the cave. But there is a secret air-filled chamber. Since the oxygen content of this air is very low, they have to use it with care. The divers cannot afford to waste this precious reserve. They will need it for the return journey. Nevertheless, the divers can go on small excursions from here. For the flexible free divers, this maze of stone doesn't pose a threat, but a diver with air tanks might find himself in peril. The cumbersome equipment could get caught in the nooks and crannies. The divers find no signs of life in the darkness of this cave. Time to make the journey back to the cave entrance, back to fresh air. To survive such a dangerous adventure requires supreme ability, self-control, and fitness. It is nothing for the faint-hearted. Fred describes what he has seen to Christian.
This cave was really an amazing experience. Even the journey into the cavern was worth it. It's superb, but we had to be very careful. Yes, you were gone for 62 minutes from the moment you started your dive. From the boat, we could see you disappear, and then you didn't resurface for 62 minutes. We had to be careful. It was a little dicey getting through that maze of stalactites and stalagmites, but it was an amazing experience. These stalactites and stalagmites are proof that this cave was above the waterline around 12 to 15,000 years ago. The sea level was about 120 meters lower then. All of these caves that you can find around here, including the famous Cascade Cave with its ancient cave paintings, now have an underwater entrance. But now they're slowly back on their way up. If you're interested, I know Pierre Chavaldonnet, who's a cave specialist. We could visit him. I think he'd be very interested to meet a free diver, because they have trouble trying to collect samples from some of the caves. So he works on the fauna of these caves. They have to dive with air tanks, and that produces a lot of bubbles, which can destroy the fragile cave ecosystems. We can go and talk to him. Yes, good idea. I'd be really keen to meet him and get a chance to see that.
So the Galabon makes its way back to Marseille. At the university's Institute for Oceanography, some sponge organisms found in the caves have attracted a lot of attention from scientists. It is thought that the sponges produce a certain toxin that could be beneficial in the treatment of illnesses like cancer and AIDS. Fred is on his way to find out more.
Yesterday we dove in the Tripri cave. Mm-hmm. It was wonderful. I love the dive with all these stalactites and this tunnel. And now I would like to know a bit more about the life in the underwater cave, because I couldn't see any fish. So I bet there is other form of life that are very interesting.
Yes, and you know there are many different kinds of caves. There are big caves and small caves. And this one is one of the biggest caves in the area. And you have also some other caves, like the 3PP cave in La Ciotat, which is going downslope when you're entering the cave. And you will notice if you go there that the waters are actually colder when you're getting in the cave, because the cold water is denser and it's heavier, so it stays in the lower parts of the cave. And these caves are very interesting because they are like the deep sea. You know, in a cave you have no light. You have almost no currents, and therefore you have almost no food coming in to the animals living in there. And we don't have all the, you know, very often the occasion to go to the deep sea. So this is an opportunity to put our tanks and go in those caves and study animals that otherwise can only be studied with submarines or robots. So can you actually stay a long time underwater, and long enough to get to the very end of those long caves to collect some samples, maybe? This is interesting because in this cave we have a problem with our own bubbles from the scuba apparatus. We actually generate big bubbles that are disturbing the environment And it is disturbing in many different ways. I told you, in caves, usually you have no currents. And those bubbles are actually creating currents in the cave. So they are disturbing the very fragile equilibrium in the caves. And furthermore, some of those deep sea sponges living on the walls of the cave, they can be detached just mechanically. They can be detached by the big bubble, our bigger bubbles. And so maybe it's an interesting thing if you can go out and very smoothly and collect things without disturbing the environment. That would be interesting for us.
I'm going diving in the cave tomorrow, so maybe we can go and dive together.
Well, unfortunately, tomorrow I cannot come with you, but I suggest I send my assistant, Livia. Can you come? And she can come with you. She can go Hello. With you on the boat, and then she would take care of the samples you will bring back on the ship.
Okay.
And bring them back to the lab.
Okay. Wonderful. Let's do that.
The Bay of La Ciotat. This is the location of the cave. Now it's essential to have a really professional briefing. It could be a matter of survival.
So like we say, Will, we dive together at the same time, so you can film and put more light, because otherwise I don't have enough light. Huh?
So okay? I'll be slightly to your left and behind.
Yes, that will be perfect.
You. Okay.
We watch each other's, okay? Signal me if you run out of air. I signal you also, so we, do the exactly the same time. Huh?
Okay.
Okay?
Yep.
On the way up, we watch each other's. It should be okay.
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 And Christian's gonna provide safety on the outside, watching.
And checking your time.
Okay.
Yeah. So if there is a problem, after 2.5 or 3 minutes, you can get in.
I'm ready to go in the cave, but not more 1.5 minutes.
Inside
the cave.
Yeah, but yeah, we will need more than 2 minutes, I think. So just be ready.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Total dive from surface to surface should be 3 minutes.
Maximum.
Yeah.
But we try to keep it between 2 and 2:30, but not more than 3 minutes. Huh?
After 2 minutes, I come in the cave.
Okay.
Most important point of the dive is that we don't go too low or too high. Mm. We go too low, we stir up the bottom of the cave. We go too high, we risk running into something. So I'll try and keep the light shining on you to illuminate you so I can film you, but also somewhat in front so you can see clearly what you need to find the stuff we need.
Okay.
Christian thinks the risk is high.
I still think this is a dangerous undertaking. But it's well organized, and since they're professionals, aware of the dangers involved, it is possible to have a go. But for amateurs, it would be impossible. After all, the cave entrance alone lies 17 meters below the water surface. Then he has to cover an additional 50 meters, and once in the cavern, it's impossible to get to the surface. So he'll have to collect some sponges for analysis, and then make the 50 meters journey back. That's about 140 meters all told. 100 meters of that, he can't come up for air. If he stays down for more than 2 minutes, I'll go into the cave to see what's going on.
But Fred and Will are confident in their abilities and go ahead with the dive.
Okay, Christian, our dive will be maximum 3 minutes.
Okay, but don't stay more 1.5 minutes inside the cave.
We'll try to do it. Yeah. I try to get the sponge in less than 1.5 minutes.
I stay outside the cave,
okay.
I waiting to you, and I checking the time, and after 1.5 minutes, I enter in the group.
We try to do as fast as we can.
Okay.
Okay.
It's a relief for the crew to see the divers surfacing again. The assignment is complete. Soon these small bits of rocks and sponges will be examined under a microscope in Marseille. Fred doesn't show any signs of exhaustion from his challenging dive.
Hello? How was it?
Everything's fine.
It wasn't too hard?
No, it might have been a little long, but it was okay.
How far was it?
30 or 40 meters. Ah, there's Christian. Everything all right? Yes, but you did give me a little bit of a fright. You were in too long. It takes its time. Yeah, of course. I dove down to the center and arrived before the time limit and took the sample. I was really stressed because of the time limit. But then I could see you. I was just about to go in myself. Really? Okay, it's done. We have the sponge.
But the sponges cannot survive for long in their small glass containers. The team makes their way back to Marseille. There is hope for the damaged waters of the Mediterranean. On their journey, Fred and Will have found healthy and recovering habitats, places where a surprising diversity of life manages to survive, and the efforts of people to clean up their coastlines and nurture life back are encouraging. Perhaps the Mediterranean will once again become the underwater Eden it once was.
What do you think after this trip, Will, and the Mediterranean?
Completely changed my opinion. I'm really surprised. There's a lot of fish, a lot of beautiful dive sites. In the top five of places I've dove in the world.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it was incredible. What was really impressive was the variety of opportunities to dive, the bottom contours, the rock formations, the abundance of fish, the different wrecks.
I told you, it can be surprising.
Very. Yeah.